Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of USA Hockey Officiating Zoomcasts. Tonight's episode is episode 22, entitled The Instructor Training Program. My name is BJ Ringrose. I'm the manager of the USA Hockey Officiating Education Program, and joining me tonight for this episode are two panelists who are not only have a wealth of experience on the ice working games under USA Hockey and other various national governing bodies, but at the same time have an extensive career off the ice and giving back as USA Hockey volunteers, particularly within development programs such as annual training seminars and development camps and the like of that. So just to start, joining me is Nick Zaglifa. Nick is from the Frederick, Maryland area, so representing the Southeastern District, been a USA Hockey official for just over 30 years. He also serves as a volunteer off the ice as the Maryland State Supervisor of Officials. He's given back for a couple of years at the Southeastern District Select Development Camp, so given back at that development camp every summer. And he has also served on the instructor training program, training programs for 4 years as an instructor himself. Also joining me is Melissa Szkola. Melissa Szkola comes from the St. Clair Shores area of Michigan, which is in the greater Detroit area. Been a USA Hockey official for just over 15 years. And also built herself up to a great career on the ice, not only working her way up through the grassroots levels and working multiple girls nationals championships under USA Hockey, but also had a great career under the IIHF, working her way up through the ladder of tournaments there, and then representing us just not too long ago at the 2018 Winter Olympics in Pyeongchang. She also serves as the Michigan District Women's Supervisor of Officials, so serves as a volunteer within the district, specifically for female officials developing out there. And has also served on the instructor camp, the instructor training program staff for 2 years as well. So welcome to you both. It's a real pleasure to have you both here. We look forward to the insight and information that you have to share with us over the course of this hour. And with that, we'll get into it. I just wanna remind everyone that if you have questions over the course of this hour, feel free to submit them using the Q&A or chat feature. You'll have a direct line of communication with myself as well as the panelists, and we'll do our best to answer those questions as they come rolling in. So before we start our first presentation for this program, we're going to start things off with a quick poll as we typically do, and we'll launch the first poll. Question number one, true or false, I currently give back as a classroom seminar instructor in my area. And the answers are true, false, or I'm not a hockey official. Question number two, if you currently volunteer on the local classroom seminar staff, what is your favorite part? And click all that apply. Sharing game experience and wisdom, developing fun and creative presentations, running efficient and productive ice sessions, public speaking, supporting in a back of the house role, completing the coffee run, I don't serve on a classroom seminar staff, or I'm not an ice hockey official. And then third question, if you're not currently volunteering at classroom seminars, which part would you prefer to help with? The classroom session, the ice sessions, or just the coffee run? And we'll give you about 10 to 20 seconds here to submit your responses. Okay, pencils down. The true or false, I currently give back as a classroom seminar instructor in my area. Looks like about just under 2/3 of you said true. And the rest of you, just under half of you, said false. So got a split group here. Some of you have already got the experience of doing classroom seminars every single year, but a lot of you obviously show a lot of interest in getting involved in classroom seminars, and hopefully we can answer a lot of your questions with how to go down that road and giving back as a volunteer. If you currently volunteer on local seminar staff, what's your favorite part? And it's kind of split amongst you, mostly being sharing game wisdom and experience with the classroom, developing fun and creative presentations, which is always a big, big plus. We're always looking for people that can find a new creative way to share information, and then running efficient and productive ice sessions. And the rest were kind of split amongst the other answer options. If you're not currently involving in classroom seminars, which part would you prefer to help with? And most of you said classroom session. That's about just over 2/3 of you said just over the classroom session, said the classroom session. And the rest of you said it was kind of a split decision between either the ice session or the coffee run. That was actually split right down the middle amongst the rest of you. So on that note, can't underestimate the coffee run. With that, we will get into our first topic presentation. We'll pass it on to Ms. Szkola, who will talk about the instructor training program itself. So go ahead and take it away, Melissa.
All right. Thanks everybody for being here tonight, and thanks BJ for having me. I'm gonna share my screen and pull up a PowerPoint here, so hold on. So how do we become an instructor? What's instructor training camp? How do we get that great collared shirt that Nick is sporting right now? That's the big question, right? So the instructor training program is really set up to help develop you as an instructor, to teach you the different aspects of putting on a seminar and to give back to the grassroots level in your area through developing of officials. So we're going to kind of dig into that a little bit. And the big topics that we cover typically as we're going through the training program is public speaking, classroom management, audio and visual aids, and conducting on-ice sessions. So over the weekend, you get a lot of practice at this after we give you some good tips and tricks for accomplishing this. So first on the list, public speaking and classroom management. Over the course of the weekend, you'll typically be paired up with a partner, and you and your partner will be presenting typically two different topics over the weekend. And those topics include anything from calling offsides to icing. And then we also have on-ice sessions that'll cover different topics too, where you're teaching the on-ice classes. I'll get to that in a minute. But within these classes then, we are teaching you how to present this information, to condense it down when necessary, and to get it across to the class effectively and efficiently. And these presentations are recorded so that you can go back and watch them. And they're critiqued both by us as staff and your peers while you're sitting in the classroom. So we all know what we want to get across most of the time. And it's really funny to then go back and watch as you're learning. And even after you've had some practice at the little things that you might do that you don't notice, maybe you talk with your hands a lot or you move around the room a lot, which can be distracting. And those are things that we cover that you might not know that you're doing, and you're getting the information across perfectly well. And then we end up with some of these things that are kind of happening in the background. So you get to practice over the course of 2 days, really, on improving some of these techniques that you're using during your public speaking and management of the classroom. And it's really fun to watch the development that happens. So that's one piece. Another piece is audio and visual aids. And this is a spot where I've developed a lot, not a strong suit of mine. And every time I help instruct an instructor's training camp, I leave, I feel like learning just as much as you guys do. And USA Hockey and BJ is really great with getting different sets of instructors. So we get mixed up and learn from each other as we go. And you can see in this picture, there's a lot of different ways to get information across. And this one, we were using balloons and we had cards up on the wall, and it's very interactive. And to me, what's really fun and interesting when we get into the audio and visual aid side of teaching in a classroom is how can we really be interactive with our group, keep everybody involved. We have a lot of different age groups a lot of times in these seminars. So how can we really pull everybody together and get that interaction that we're looking for? So there's a lot to be learned and a lot to be shared. And it's always fun even hearing from those of you participating who might be teachers and work in these different settings that have experience like this too. And I know with all of us being on Zoom this year, we've even learned a lot more through these Zoom meetings, how to be interactive. And that's going to transition into some of our seminar classroom settings too. So audio and visual aids is really fun. There's always something new, and it really keeps your seminar exciting to come to, so that you're not just sitting through the same information every year, sitting in a chair, being bored. So it's really fun way to mix things up and get information across to people in a format that might be new for you as well. I know I mentioned earlier on-ice sessions. we get you guys on the ice as well and teaching you how to teach on the ice. So ice time is expensive, as we all know. So we want to make sure that we're being productive with our time out there. And if we have a large group of officials on the ice, how do we break it down into smaller groups and make sure everybody knows what their task is in teaching? And within that, then, how are we getting the information to our officials quickly so that we're actually running drills on the ice so we can give that feedback and teaching for them, and not spending most of our time talking? Talking can be done in the classroom where it's less expensive. So we want to make sure that we're on point with how we get the information across, what we're asking of them while they're on the ice, and being able to give feedback in the moment so that they're improving and helping the new officials improve as they're learning to teach this as well. So you're really just learning different skills to be able to teach effectively both on and off the ice. And it's a ton of fun. It's a ton of fun. Our training programs take place regionally. One of them happens in Lake Placid, which is really fun. I'm sure everybody on here is a hockey fan and would love to see the rink and skate on the 1980 ice. We don't always get that opportunity, but you always get to see it if you don't get to skate on it. And it's just a really unique experience. And the other location is Colorado Springs, Colorado. So between the two of these locations, you stay right on site there at the Olympic Training Centers. It's a 4-day camp. We typically start on a Thursday, end on a Sunday, kind of, we'll say early afternoon. In the springtime is when these take place, a couple weeks from each other. And the days are set up to kind of be filled the whole day. So we typically start breakfast around 7 a.m. We meet in the classroom around 8:15. And we cover basically two classroom sessions and two ice sessions for the full day, Friday and Saturday. You get a lot of opportunity to be up and moving around. Breakfast and lunch is at the training center as well. So you get to kind of see where the athletes are training. You get to see the facilities. Again, skate in Lake Placid, if that's the region that you're in. It's really unique and a lot of fun. I definitely highly recommend it. And the way that all happens and you kind of get started into this process, you'd want to talk to your local referee in chief. They would put your name in. If you're selected to attend, you would get an email by March 15th, typically. So you can start planning your time away and get prepared for your time at camp. And the biggest thing that we want you guys to leave camp with is really, to me, an inspired attitude to head back home to help in some form or fashion. If it's a coffee run, let me tell you, there are days where you're my most important person. But if it's working on the ice and helping teach a new official how to drop a puck, we need that. We need you guys in the classroom. And we really just want to see that energy. And like I said, there's so much to be learned and it changes every year, all the time. And to bring that information back to the seminars, there's a lot of times we kind of get caught in a rut as seminar instructors that have been doing it for a while, because it's easy. It's what we're used to. You set this up here, you do this here, this person does that. And to get some fresh blood in there with some new ideas, it just really changes it up and it's so much fun. So any of you guys out there who haven't participated in a camp yet, I say, look into it, talk to those of us who have. It's a lot of fun. You're gonna meet great people that are going to become lifelong friends, and your local association can definitely use your help. And new officials out there, even if you don't want to work in the seminars per se, there's always officials that you're going to be skating with that you'll be able to use some of the same techniques and teaching skills with to just help improve them on a one-on-one level. So we're always looking for help and anybody willing to donate their time and get in there and help out, because we've all had those people. So if you guys have any questions, hit up the chat. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And then BJ, if we have any other questions.
Thanks, Melissa. Really, really well done. A lot of great information to share there. Just Just to quickly clarify a little bit with the whole process, Mo did a really, really good job of outlining how the process works as far as if you have interest and want to go. If I can go down the road just a little more, few more details, is typically our acceptance portal for applications and all that. Our that window usually opens sometime right around December, the end of December, early January. We'll actually put the dates up for the upcoming program for the following spring up there. And then we put you in the direction of your district RIC to get an application. If you want to go, you can either reach out directly to your district RIC, or you can go through, say, your state supervisor or local supervisor if you want someone to kind of back you and channel you. But basically, you kind of have to advocate for yourself. The application process is really, really simple. Once you get the green light to apply, it's through an online portal. We collect all the information. And then once we get everything in, we just send all the applications back to their respective district referees and chiefs for them to review one last time and make sure, yep, this person's good to go. Yep, this person's good to go. And so forth before we ultimately send out acceptance. But beyond that, once you're accepted, you're good to go. You'll get an invitation formally from us, and we'll give you some logistics as far as arrival and stuff like that. But just to also point out, the dates for the upcoming 2021 programs have not been released yet. We're in the early phases of starting to talk with the United States Olympic and Paralympic training centers about what their hosting possibilities can be. Obviously, with the COVID situation, it kind of presents some hurdles and challenges that we might be able to go there and we might be able to host our program there. They might say, you know what, just due to the, because the fact that they do have world-class athletes training right now. We have the Tokyo 2020 games, technically, happening in Tokyo this summer. There's a lot of athletes on the sites actually training for the upcoming games, not to mention their own world championships and everything they have coming up. So we certainly understand and respect the fact that the USOPC wants to do everything they can to kind of protect them and their well-being. So there's a chance that may not happen. So we're looking at other opportunities and other things that we could possibly do to make those programs happen. Just to kind of throw a question to you both, and maybe we'll start with Nick. Mo talked about the classroom sessions, how the instructors present during the classroom sessions through the day. And she kind of hit some of the topics that we do. Is there any particular topic, Nick, that you like to do?
I'm a big fan of the topic, making seminars fun. All right. And basically just you taking some ideas that you've come across, you've come up with, you've developed, and some other ideas to make it fun. I believe that when you when you're having a little bit more fun in a classroom setting, your students are gonna absorb more information if they're enjoying themselves. So I love teaching that particular topic. That if there is a favorite, you know, that would be mine.
Is there any particular creative ideas you come up with to kind of jazz up and put a little jam into your seminars?
It's been a little bit of a challenge this year, obviously being mostly virtual. We still try to push that envelope and to make it fun, you know, with a lot of use of videos and interactions and so on. But there's some one of my favorites was, okay, we would bring everyone outside and, all right, we're going to go over some positioning. And I'm like, ah, great. You know, it's a level 3. Ah, great. We can go outside and go over positioning. And I had the instructors do a very well choreographed melee. Okay. It was a choreographed basically disaster.
You kind of set up a game setting and then staged a fight is what you're saying.
Exactly. Exactly. And we had helmets removed, but one didn't have their helmet strapped, and it wasn't just, okay, everyone, let's just jump on everybody. It was very meticulously planned and practiced because we're trying to emphasize certain penalty situations. And then after it was all done, we're like, okay, we broke everyone up at teams of three, go write an incident report. And they're like, what? And we recorded it. Actually, I had two people record it. And we went over their incident reports. And it's amazing because I don't know, maybe outside of Maryland, you know, your fights or altercations are well planned in advance and you're notified ahead of time, but where I live, it is not. And yet they come when you least expect it, and so on, you know? So, and you only have seconds to react, and you know, and you have to remember, you have to write this down, and what did you see, what didn't you see, and so on. And we had a great, it was very successful. I think it definitely got the point across, and that's important. You want to make it fun, but at the same time, your objective is to teach and have these officials learn from these things. Much better to learn, you know, from a mistake sort of in a seminar or, you know, in a simulated situation than on the ice. Now, you learn just as effective that way as well, you know, but anyway, so that was a lot of fun and effective. But then when you do that, you can't do that every year. Nope. you're gonna have to come up with a new one, you know. But that's what makes it fun. That's what makes it challenging.
That's fantastic. How about you, Mo? Got any, is there any particular topics at the instructor training program that you enjoy teaching?
I think for those of you who have been there, this one won't surprise you at all, but I love teaching the on-ice sessions for sure. Anytime I can get people just a little bit uncomfortable on the ice and teach them just something, have them walk away with something maybe they didn't think about before, to just push the edge just a little bit, and really see over a couple ice sessions a change in that individual is really fun to me. And to know that they're going to go home and hopefully have that moment with somebody else too, I just love seeing the change. It's, to me, a lot of times very dramatic, and it's really exciting to know that we really have a small amount of time with people and can have an impact like that, and know that they'll be able to go home and share that too. And I also like talking about public speaking, of course. So those would be my two favorites, I think.
Fantastic. Thanks for answering those questions, guys. Okay, we're going to move into the second part of our presentation. And before we get to that, we're going to launch a second poll. First question of the second poll: whether you're currently on seminar staff or not, what would you consider your weakness as an instructor? So potentially, if you're in the front of the room and you're already participating in seminars, what do you think your greatest weakness might be? Or if you were to just get started, what do you think your weakness might be? And if you don't see it listed there amongst the choices, being public speaking, managing technology like AV aids, keeping your presentations or ice session drills on time, finding creative ways to teach topics, you can always enter your answer choice into the chat feature if you want to enter something different. Question number two: agree or disagree? All classroom seminar staff should be required to complete recertification. So in other words, once you've gone through the formal training in Lake Placid or Colorado Springs, do you agree with the idea that there should be some sort of a continuing education program for all classroom seminar staff? And the agreements, you could agree to it for every 2 or 3 years, every 5 or 6 years, or every 8 to 10 years, or you could completely disagree with it and just say, I'm done learning stuff for now. So give you about another 10 to 20 seconds or so to submit your answers. Okay, we'll wrap that up. And with 24 out of our 27 districts reporting, whether or not you're currently serving on the seminar staff or not, what would you consider your greatest weakness as an instructor? And looks like overall, the keeping your presentations and ice session drills on time is one of the, is, you know, the bigger one. It's kind of split amongst everything. Finding creative ways to teach topics is certainly a challenge. Managing technology is definitely a challenge for some people. Some are certainly better than others. And the same thing with public speaking. Not everyone's the greatest public speaker in the world. And some people have a hard time getting over that hurdle. But keeping your presentations and size sessions, it's a big one. And it's certainly something that a lot of people can struggle with. I'll be the first one to say that when I get up in the front of the room, you can ask any of the seminar instructor staff that I work with. I can be a little long-winded and I can lose track of the clock sometimes. So we actually teach some tips and some pointers with how to work your presentations into the correct time frame. So if it's supposed to be 15 minutes long, There's tips and tricks that you can do to ultimately keep yourself within that 15-minute time frame, so you're not necessarily setting the next guy up to fail by running too long. Question number two, I agree or disagree. All classroom seminar staff should be required to complete recertification. And overwhelmingly, and happily, I'm happy to announce that most of you agree with it. Agree on a five to six year scale. You think every 5 to 6 years, all seminar staff, instructors, seminar coordinators should have to go through some type of recertification program. And that's something we're certainly looking into right now within the referee section of USA Hockey about launching something like that to go through the formal training, say in Lake Placid or Colorado Springs, and then suddenly 10 years goes by and you haven't really, you know, touched on that at all. I mean, obviously we're always talking about rule knowledge, positioning, mechanics of being an official in our seminars, but you know, the mentality and the mission of the instructor training program is you're teaching the teachers. When you come to that program, we won't talk about rules. We will not talk about positioning. We won't talk about mechanics or anything like that. We talk about teaching, public speaking, audio visual aids, you know, managing your on-ice sessions and things like that. Things that ultimately set seminars up for success. So the fact that you can go like 10 years without revisiting the fundamentals and even learning about updates and AV technology and new tools that are out there to use, that's something that we're discussing now within the referee section. So with that poll wrapped up, I will now kick it over to Mr. Zaglifa, who is going to talk about seminar instructor and seminar instructor skills. So go ahead and take it away, Nick.
All right, hopefully everyone should see that, I'm hoping. All right, good, all right. So first off, thanks so much for having me, BJ. And Mo, it's great to teach with you again. We worked, what, Lake Placid, what, 4 years ago?
Yeah, 4 years ago already.
How sweet was that? All right.
It was amazing.
So cool. All right. Thanks all of you for joining us. So I've been an instructor for about 24 years and had the awesome opportunity to teach instructors camp on more than one occasion. So what are your district RICs looking for in a seminar instructor? So let's go over some of the qualities of a seminar instructor that we're looking for. Okay. First off, obviously we're looking for people who are experienced and knowledgeable. That makes sense. Good role models on and off the ice. Obviously enthusiastic, energetic, confident, and then definitely a desire to give back to the grassroots level. That's very important. All right, real quick, I want to give a shout out to the Uncle Sam image that I stole off the internet from the Massachusetts Officiating Program. Okay, moving along. All right, a good instructor knows the rules. All right, knows the difference between this or this. Is it a major in a game misconduct or a match? You will be asked those questions and you need to know, you know, what those rules are and be comfortable with them and knowledgeable and experienced. Not only that, you need to be familiar with the spirit of those rules. Okay. What is the purpose? What is the foundation of those rules? All right. And not only that, but why do you have to be in that particular place at that particular time? All right. And understand the positioning and so on. Okay. Be very comfortable with that red basic manual. Love the red basic manual. All right. Long after the seminar, you have to understand that you are still teaching. People recognize you from in front of the room. When you're skating games, and I travel to different rinks around the state of Maryland and the in Virginia and the District of Columbia. So I see different refs I haven't skated with, but they recognize me from standing in front of the classroom. So even after the seminar, you're still teaching. All right. When you show up 10 minutes before the game, then it must be okay for me to show up 10 minutes before the game. So it's important that you are being that, setting that great example for all refs, whether they're new refs or experienced refs. So I definitely make a point of showing up 30 minutes before game time, if I'm doing my, you know, my big 16U tilt, okay? All right, setting that good example goes a long way, and it helps the program. All right. If you put tape on your fingers, they will see that, and without really understanding why, they're going to put tape on their fingers as well. Okay, I've seen it, you know, so just keep that in mind. All right, your actions after the seminar are just as influential if you were just standing up in front of that classroom. So being a good role model is very important. Enthusiasm. Don't get me wrong, I enjoy teaching seminars, okay? But what makes situations like the Zoomcast or teaching at a development camp is your audience wants to be there, okay? Instead of required to be there. There's a difference. I personally enjoy audiences like this because you're taking the time. This is not a requirement. You're here to just basically expand your horizons and learn some stuff about the instructor program, as well as all the other, you know, the previous 21 episodes. You're here to just expand, which is fantastic. But seminar instructors, we teach seminars, and seminars are a requirement. So how many of you have attended some sort of class or training where your instructor just didn't want to be there? Okay. All right. We've all been there. I've been there. I've been that person. But, you know, on occasion, but before the coffee run. All right. But it's important, you know, to have that enthusiasm. Now imagine an instructor who pumps you up, gets you fired up. Okay. All right. So just as if you are signaling that goal in that big game, okay, with that enthusiasm, you need to bring that enthusiasm to the classroom, all right? And believe it or not, it's contagious. Even with the, you know, the beer league level threes who've been doing it forever and they're there just to get certified and get out, you may not fire them up as much as you would, you know, your younger officials, all right? But you will have much more success bringing that enthusiasm to the seminar, to the classroom. All right. Much like the enthusiasm, you need energy. I mean, not Kendall Coyne energy, but you know what? I'll take it. All right. I'll take it. All right. The energy you show on the ice should be the same energy that is shown in the classroom. Okay. All right. Feed that energy to the participants who want it. You're going to have a good part of your learners are they want to advance their game. They want to raise the level of their game. All right. So give them that energy that they need to feed on. All right. But just as well. Okay. I don't know what I clicked there. Sorry. Got a little fired up with the mouse here. There we go. So share that energy to those who don't. All right. Seminar instructors, they need to be confident. All right. Those that confidence is tough to teach. I believe at instructors camp though, that we provide that environment where we can help build your confidence, especially on the ice. All right, one of my favorite roles. Look, I would love to be the power skater instructor. I would love to. All right, the perks that they get, the limos and so on is fantastic. I would love to be that person. I'm just not, all right? I got the engine, I just don't have the suspension, all right? But one of my favorite roles though is supporting that power skating instructor, whether it's Mo or whoever is teaching it, you know, to build the confidence in that individual. And I think Mo said it great, where that person will be appreciative of it and then pass it on, you know, and use that skill. That's another skill that we're trying to teach these instructors, all right, is how to pass that on, build these people up, okay? So we're always looking for confident individuals, all right? And once again, the confidence that you show on the ice, you need to bring to the classroom, all right? So when I found this picture of the classroom and everyone's all crammed together, it's like, huh, just the COVID-ness of it. So I had to throw in a Zoom, okay? All right, and then we need that desire to give back to our game, all right? I want to give a shout out to Coach Terry Clay from Wausau, Wisconsin, over 30 years ago, who told me after practice to show up the next morning for a seminar. He was a great coach of the game. He was my coach, so when Coach says you're going somewhere, you're going, so I did. And I've been a registered official ever since. So did you have a great mentor or coach during your young hockey career? All right. I'm sure you have. Okay. Who is your coach, Clay, in your situation? All right. What characteristics did that individual have? How about that supervisor, that evaluator? Okay. Or that instructor, or just a senior official. Okay. If maybe, you know, in instructor camp, maybe you may not think it's right for you, but you can still pass on a lot of these characteristics just being a senior official working with level ones or level twos. It's very important. You know, I wish I could, you know, evaluate every game, you know, in my state. I just can't, you know, I'm just unable to do that. So that's why I count on those senior officials. You know, they're just as responsible for passing on the word as we are as seminar instructors, all right? And we can't emphasize this enough, but the success of the officiating program does depend on thousands of awesome volunteers, you know, that's for sure. All right, and I love these Hockey Weekend Across America gigs. You know, it's one of the thrills I have as state supervisor is calling a kid and, you know, and even calling a parent and calling that parent and say, hey, are you two available? Absolutely. I'm like, can I call in 10 minutes? Just have your son answer the phone or daughter. And it just makes me thrilled to death. And I'm so glad USA Hockey has that program, you know, so, and I always tell the kids, you make sure you ask those refs questions and a lot of them. And I want to know the answers so I learn something too, okay? All right. So another big thing, all right. Yes, instructor camp will help you become, we will teach you the skills, just like BJ said, we will teach you the skills, you know, to become successful seminar instructors. But there are a lot of benefits to the instructor training program besides this. I work for a regional home builder. And not long after I started to travel to teach hockey officiating, my manager asked me to train new employees for our department. And then that transitioned to training newly hired project managers in the field. So I use the same skills. I would use fancy PowerPoints with video clips in them, but it was all about home building, you know, but use that same enthusiasm and so on. And it really took off. So the skills learned in instructor training not only can help your game as an official, right? Because the best way to learn something is to teach it, right? So that's one way of looking at it. So the skills learned instructor training can help your game elevate the game of your learners for sure, because that's the main focus, but quite possibly help advance your career off the ice in your profession. And that's been huge. So I do some public speaking at the office. I will, you know, teach different training. Sometimes it's a small group. Sometimes it's a group of 100. And I get just as nervous if I'm teaching icing, okay? But it's just thrilling for me, and I love to do it. So you're gonna walk out of instructor's camp a much better public speaker, all right? Are you gonna be a politician? Well, you could, but you'll definitely be better public speaker walking into that camp or walking out of that camp is when you walked in. We're gonna build those skills. And just like on the ice, as we build up your confidence on the ice, we're gonna build your confidence as a public speaker, all right? As Mo mentioned, you know, putting together a successful presentation and so on, and you'll get that feedback right away. So you'll know how well you're doing right from the get-go and so on. And like, again, these skills, you know, you can take this into your careers, you know, off the ice. Okay. But the biggest thing is, you'll be prepared and expected. I should have put that in there, darn it. And expected to pass on what you've learned to, you know, that grassroots level. All right. So I was teaching in a conference where I had a chance to meet Kim Peterson from Denmark, and I borrowed this quote. Officials, we are guardians of our game. All right. And same goes for all of the volunteers and all the people that help make this game possible and what it is today. On ice officials, we are definitely guardians of the game, and in instructors help keep that legacy going. All right. Now I'm gonna unshare.
Thanks, Nick. Lots of great information shared right there. And just want to point out in reference to your Uncle Sam picture, we actually do have two representatives from Mass Hockey actually on this Zoom cast right now. So with that, I'll say to those guys, well, thank you for the use of your icon, and we'll see you in court for the intellectual property rights. So one thing you talk about, Nick, and actually it kind of even goes back to my question, the poll question at the very, very beginning, is the whole idea between strengths versus weaknesses. And you talked about how much you'd love to be a power skating instructor. It's fun to be the power skating instructor, because you're out there on the ice and all eyes are on you, and you're given the big presentation and demonstrating the drills and so forth. But you know, though, everybody has limits. And just because you may not necessarily be the best public speaker in the world, or you may not be a strong skater on the ice, correct me if I'm wrong, Nick, but you know, there are still other opportunities. You'll find if you really, really want to get involved, there's an opportunity for everyone, correct, Nick?
Oh, that is absolutely correct. And I do not, when people want to step up and help out with anything from evaluations to seminar prep to to whatever, we always have those needs, you know. So absolutely. Absolutely.
Anything you want to add on to that, Mo?
I just tell people you can never have enough people volunteering to help. I have space anywhere. You tell me what you're interested in, and I will help develop you in that area. I'll ask you to, you know, step outside your comfort zone in some other areas, but that doesn't mean that that's where you need to be and to live the whole time. We're definitely, there's a spot for everybody. We'll find it. If you want to help, we need you, and you'll be successful at it for sure.
Great. Thanks, Mo. One thing I've kind of always had the belief in, and hopefully you both would agree with me on this, there is a development aspect to being a seminar instructor, I think. Now, it's one thing to actually go get the training. It's not much different than showing up to a level one seminar, being an official, literally scared out of your socks. You never carried a whistle in your life. You never read the rule book. You know, there's that first experience of gaining all the knowledge, but even then you go on and gain levels, and through game experience, you become a better official. I'll start with Mo. Do you think it's similar as a seminar instructor?
Yeah, absolutely. And you can plan and prepare just like you can for a game. And just like Zag said, you know, those fights don't happen planned. All of a sudden something happened, you're like, what did I just see? The same thing can happen at a seminar. I know one of the first seminars I did on my own, we couldn't get the computer connected. So we ended up having absolutely no visual aids, we'll say, and we had to kind of think on the fly. And luckily those of us that were there were able to really kind of pull it together. And it's stuff that you talk about and you hope doesn't happen, but it does, you know, and every time you do it, you learn a little bit more. And just like I said, doing, teaching different instructors camps with different instructors, you take something away every time. And hopefully you leave a seminar going, you know, what could I do better and what really worked, and you develop as you go. So those first few, yeah, just like you said, I have to step on the ice. I just blew my whistle. I don't even know what the penalty's on. I did that. What player? I don't know. And you leave the seminar, you get in there doing the same thing and you leave and you're like, okay, I can do this. And yeah, absolutely. Development.
Hey, Nick, anything to add?
Oh yeah. We've seen power outages, canceled ice, no ice. We would show up at the rink and the classroom was all set, but we look and we just see a bunch of sand and no ice at all. So, all right, kids, we're heading outside to the parking lot, you know? So yes, there is some on the fly stuff that goes, along too, but, that's what makes it fun. And we're, you know, and most of your students know, you know, what we're trying to do and so on, but, you know, it definitely keeps you light in your toes for sure.
Sure. There's no question. You have to learn to be adaptable. It's
oh yes.
Yeah. Even like, it's like adjusting yourself to the game. You may have a smooth running track meet of a game flowing up and down. Then all of a sudden the temperature goes up for whatever reason. Maybe it's close and it's getting down to the wire. Maybe a hit occurs and, you know, you call the penalty, but for whatever reason, the opposing team just can't get over it. And now suddenly the temperature rises a little bit. And now you have to adjust yourself a little bit. You got to bring your presence up and you have to adapt to the game. So those types of those situations will occur in your classroom or on the ice where you find yourself thinking on your toes. How do I react? How do I respond? And how do I manage this situation? Another thing, we certainly talk a lot within the USA Hockey Officiating Program, especially with brand new officials, is the mentor program. Did either of you, and maybe we'll start with Mo, did you have a mentor as an instructor? Was there someone that either kind of took you under their wing and kind of showed you a thing or two, or at the very least, there was someone that you watched in seminars? This is someone I need to watch. This is someone I can definitely learn from as far as presentations. What do you think?
Yeah, I think I had multiple, to be honest. I think locally, I had a couple guys that I always kind of watched and who have taught me, here's how it's going to happen. If I'm not here, this is what you're going to need to do, locally. But then of course, all of you guys, BJ, Nick too. I remember my first instructor training and I was like, I have no idea what I'm doing. And I had an Apple computer and it didn't connect right. And I had to send email. It was a mess. But you learn, and you have guys like you two that are willing to take the time to kind of share the insight and show different apps that you can use for building different PowerPoints, whether it's an iPad and all those kind of things. And I there's so many, I couldn't name all of them who have helped along the way, whether it came to on the ice or instructing. It's amazing the number of people that are willing to spend the time to teach you, to teach others. And I think that for me is why it's so important to continue, because there were so many people that were willing to take the time to help me that I want to be able to do that for others and hopefully inspire them. So yeah, so many people willing to help.
Great. Thanks, Mo. How about you, Nick? Did you have a mentor from seminar teaching standpoint?
Oh my goodness. Well, real quick, as Mo was mentioning, it's that teamwork, because we all work together, you know, as the staff, and as well as, because it definitely is absorbed by the class. All right, we've seen that. I've seen that, and if most, if not all of our classes, there's there's someone who knows everything about computers in your class. There just is. And it's pure luck. I don't know if BJ, if you know who these people are, but there's always an a participant who has all the cords, who has all the adapters, you know, and so on. So it's just that part is amazing. There have been a lot there of instructors that I've had over the years that just what I try to be is as authentic as possible as well. That just brings so much authenticity to not only their game when you watch them skate as well as in the classroom, you know, and they always seem to have not just the right answer like in a know-it-all send up, but just the answer and the explanation to bring it all together. And that's something I strive to be as not only as a supervisor, but as an instructor, you know. You know, why do we do this? Because I said so. Nah, it ain't gonna cut it. You know, there's a reason. What is that reason? You know, what, you know, and get that point across. Brett Parson definitely stands out to me. He taught my district officiating seminar along with Matt Leaf in 19 in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. Okay. And that I was hooked. It was a DOS. I loved it. And from that point on, that's when I'm like, officiating hockey is going to be a big part of my life. I think I was like a first year level 3 when I went to that, and I just loved it, you know. And then he also taught at my instructor's camp later on in 19. And he was full of energy. Oh, that dude was full of energy. And he had definitely, you know, really cool ways to get his point across, which was fantastic.
Thanks, Nick. And for those of you who just couldn't quite get the year he was trying to talk about very, very clearly, it was 1996 that Nick attended the program in Lake Placid. In the post edit, we might actually even put the year on the bottom as he's actually titles, just to clarify, it might not quite have gone through. It's not your Wi-Fi connection. Anyway. Getting on to the questions from a couple of the panelists, we got a great question here. Is it a requirement to go to instructor training program before offering to help out at a seminar? I'll throw this one to you, Nick, only because as the Maryland State Supervisor, you obviously run a lot of seminars in your area and you do a lot of recruitment. So if someone came to you and said, hey, I want to get involved, I want to help out, would it be necessarily, do you have to go to Lake Placid first, or is there a way to get involved without going?
No. The definite, the easy answer to that question is no. I lean on experienced officials to help out and who I think would be, effective. And there'll be some people come up to me and say, hey, I'm interested, but I'm not quite sure if I'm the right. I'm like, well, hey, come on, help us out at a seminar. And see if you like it. Well, you know, we'll give you offsides. Here's your materials that you can use, and let me know. And the other thing too, especially on the ice, if I happen to be short, you know, generally I like to have 5 instructors for an ice session. Okay, and any more, you know, better. But if I'm short, I will lean on an experienced person that I know that. You know, that's a good skater or whatever the case may be. So is it a requirement? No, to become, you know, to get all of those benefits, yes, that's where instructors camp will come into play.
Great, Nick, thanks. Other question, and I'll go pass this one on to Mo. You do a lot of recruitment as well and work with a lot of seminar instructors, and you certainly have a wealth of experience on the ice. And a lot of information to share. What do you feel is the minimum experience required And I presume that they're asking about game experience and working games. What do you think that minimum experience would be before becoming an instructor?
On a personal level, I don't know if I'd say there's necessarily a certain level that you need to attain to become an instructor and to want and have the desire to go to camp. Like we've all touched on throughout this talk, there's so many places you can be used, and it doesn't mean that you need to be an Olympic official or an NCAA official. I don't think that's necessary at all. I think it's helpful when you're talking about high level game situations and that kind of stuff, but so many people have so many good qualities that there's, I mean, an abundance. It's not just what you've officiated on the ice that's going to make you a good seminar staff instructor. It just, to me, it isn't. So as much as I think it can be helpful in certain situations, I think there's a place for everybody. If you want to give back in the highest level hockey that you did was, you know, double A hockey or house hockey, we still have a place for you. You can still help. You can still teach. Absolutely.
Well, even possible, there's always those support staff roles as well. Not necessarily. And we talked a little bit about this. Kevin Donovan and Dave Labuda were on this a couple weeks ago on the Zoom cast. We talked about volunteer opportunities. And one of the great things that Kevin pointed out was, you know, when you come out of, say, fresh out of instructor training, you're doing your first seminar, we're not going to throw you in the deep end of the pool. You're not going to get up there in front of a bunch of KG veteran level threes and give the judgment speech. Like it's a big topic. It's a broad topic. It's a big challenging topic for us. So you might start out with something like pregame duties or appearance or something like that, a nice soft topic just to get your feet wet and get the experience and be comfortable. It's no different from you go out there on the ice and be comfortable with being the man in charge or the female in charge out there. Just get used to carrying a whistle out there on the ice. Well, no different in the classroom. Get used to being the person in the front of the room, giving the information and pass the information along and using a PowerPoint presentation to make your points and so forth. There's a certain comfort level. But with that said, there's even other roles as well. You know, checking people in at the beginning of the seminar, you know, posting and taking down signs, directing traffic, and all sorts of stuff that if you want to get involved and you haven't had any formal training, you can still get involved and get active in a volunteer level. And, you know, basically you two have certainly hit it home, and we hit it home with Dave Labuda and Kevin Donovan, that we constantly need volunteers. We constantly need people who are willing to step up and even to just give a day, a Saturday or a Sunday. You know what? For that one day, at least, it makes life a little bit easier for the coordinator and the people who are ultimately coordinating that particular event. So with that, as you notice, we've come up to the top of the hour and we've even gone a little bit past. So as usual, I'm keeping my streak alive of running along with my presentations. I don't think I've ever come in under 60 minutes ever. So we will begin to wrap things up. So I'm going to share my screen and share the upcoming schedule that we have. As you can see, this is episode 22, the instructor training program. And coming up next week, we have exploding games. We've all been there, whether you're working your first year experience out there working games, or whether you're a KG veteran working with 20 years worth of experience and worked multiple games. Well, one of us experienced that point where for whatever reason, the game goes off the rails and it's going down the drain. And what do we do? How do we react? Scott Zelkin's going to be in the captain's chair for that one. He's going to be joined by Aaron Blair and Steve McKinchak, both heavily decorated IHF and NCAA officials with a lot of experience as referees at those high levels. They'll talk about the signs to look for, you know, how to notice when the temperature's rising and how to react to that sort of stuff, and even managing players. How do you manage players either in preparation where you see things starting to go sideways, or when things have officially gone sideways and we got to figure out some way to get this thing back on track. The week after that, we have USA Hockey Discipline. We're going to talk about the overall player development, the player discipline within USA Hockey and that structure, how the various discipline committees across USA Hockey, they work with disciplinary hearings. But most importantly, we'll bring it back to our world within the officiating world of game reports and why game reports are so critical to that process. How to file a correct game report, what are the elements that representatives on disciplinary committees look for, and why other things that make those reports so important. And then on December 8th, we have ADM and officiating. No question, the ADM has been around within USA Hockey for coming up on 11 years now. And we've seen a lot of success with player development and player keeping players around, player longevity within the game. They work their way up through youth hockey and even sticking around, whether it be college club, whether it be we're playing adult league with their buddies afterwards. But coming out of that ADM, that's where they build that passion for playing the game. So what is the role? What is the official's role within the American development model? Where do we play? When we're actually working the games with these young players, when they're developing and up and coming, and they've come out of their fun small area games, practices, and maybe they've played some cross ice hockey and they're actually playing a formally structured game with officials out on the ice. What is our role as officials as we play into that continued process as they come up through the 10 and under level and 12 and under level and so on? So that's our upcoming schedule. As you noticed also, we have social media channels. You saw the Twitter feed as well as the Instagram feed posted there. Feel free to look for us, USA Hockey Officiating. You'll find us on both Twitter and Instagram. Look at those platforms. Easy to find, easy to keep up with, and most importantly, easy to like and follow. So by all means, jump on board. Also, you'll have a survey reminder for all the participants within this Zoomcast. As soon as we wrap up here, you will get an invitation to submit a survey based on what you saw. And this is your opportunity to give us feedback. No different from any of our other camps and programs, we always want the participants' feedback and advice because that's the best way that we can make this program better and more successful and serve your needs. Most importantly, we do ask for topics. We're always looking for interesting topics that cater to what our participants out there want to see us talk about and discuss and present to our loyal followers. Also want to thank the participants. Whether this is the first time you've ever joined us on the Zoomcast, welcome. And we hope to see you on future Zoomcasts down the road as we continue with this, or whether you're one of our dedicated supporters that have seen us for, 22 episodes now. Thank you so much for your loyalty and support and coming back week after week. We really, really enjoy doing this week in and week out. Enjoy presenting and sharing information with you. And as a reminder, you can always, whether you're here in the live Zoomcast itself, you can always find all recorded Zoomcast on demand at the Zoomcast page at usahockey.com and find all of our past presentations there. With that, I'll wrap things up. I want to thank Nick Zaglifa and Melissa Szkola as our panelists. Thank you so much for giving just another hour out of your time as a volunteer and giving back to USA Hockey and presenting and sharing all the great information that you had. So with that, we'll wrap things up. Wish everyone a safe and successful season, and thank you for your dedication to USA Hockey.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.